Hello and welcome to Casio's online course for the new and improved color ClassPad. In this session we will be taking a closer look at the sequence application. If you're at the main icon menu, you can tap and drag to the left to show sequence on that second page. If we tap sequence, you'll see that we have available to us recursive and explicit formulas that we can define. And if we take a quick look at the toolbar up here, you have some basic copy-paste. You can change the type of your, in this case, your recursive sequence. It can be a sub n plus 1 based, which has a single preceding term, or a sub n plus 2, which can be based on two preceding terms, for instance, the Fibonacci sequence. And as you define these, if you want access to, for instance, a sub n, you can get it here, or b sub n, or c sub n, as you will. These become available as needed. So let's quickly set this up to take a look at the Fibonacci sequence. Now we can get the type set here or from the toolbar. Hopefully this makes some sense, a sub n plus 1 or a sub n plus 2. I'll pick this one. So for Fibonacci sequence, we want a sub n plus 2 to be a sub n plus 1 plus a sub n. We want a sub 1 to be 1, a sub 2 to be 1. I press execute to store. I'm going to activate this by putting a checkbox, and I can generate my table of values. A key point, right now you'll notice this has the blue border to show that this window has focus. You'll notice that this toolbar is slightly different when I tap at the top and I shift my focus. So just keep in mind, I don't want you to get lost if you perhaps have a different focus window than I do. So if you're down here at the table, we can adjust the table settings by clicking on this button. You can change the start and end points. Perhaps we want 10 values instead, and you'll see that those are now available. There is also there's a few separate ways of making a table. There's the standard basic table, and if I'm working with Fibonacci sequence, I can also create a table like this, and it'll actually show you the sum, and you can kind of verify that we have 2358, 2358. This is a good way of verifying a Fibonacci-like sequence. We'll also change the setup here to do a sub n plus 1, and let's say it's based on a sub n plus 3, a sub n plus 3, and let's let my a sub 0 be 1. Now I don't want the Fibonacci layout down here. Instead, I think I'll go for a standard, I'll go for a standard arithmetic sequence. Let me show you that again. Arithmetic is this B minus A, which means a common difference, and we just want to verify we have a common difference, and sure enough, we do have a common difference. So that's another handy table tool to check differences. There's also a tool to check geometric sequences or the common ratio. So for that, I'm going to change this to 3 times a sub n, and my initial term I will set to 2, maybe, just to mix things up. And now if I do the ratio table, we can, or quotient, we can check that quotient and verify that yes, it is indeed a constant quotient, which should be the same as we see right here in my function. We can also put in an explicit function. Let's say the explicit form of a sub n is equal to n squared minus 2. So I'll grab n from here, n squared minus 2, press execute to store, automatically gets checked. And so I can just get a quick check of that table of values. There's no fancy thing necessary here since it's just explicit. And lastly, I want to go back to recursion. I will go here and clear the sheet. And let's put in a sub n plus 1 again. Is 2 a sub n plus 2, and perhaps we'll start at 3 execute. And now I want to show you one last layout, which is called the progression of difference table. And it shows you the constantly escalating difference for an example like this. Another nice thing, if you see right here, this gives you a computation screen. And so from here I can do some quick calculations, and one of the calculations that probably you would find helpful is called rSolve right here. Calculate rSolve. And what rSolve will do is, if I give it a recursion statement, it will solve it and turn it into an explicit formula. So for instance, if I have a sub n plus 1 equal to 2a sub n, or no, let's say 3a sub n minus 1, and let's say a sub 1 equals 1. What this will do is turn it into an explicit formula that should give me the exact same sequence of values. So that's a really, really handy tool. Also, if we need to shut this down, keep in mind that if it's got focus and it's an auxiliary window that's kind of covering up what was already there, we can just hit X to exit out of there. And what I want to do now is I want to create a graph. Let me start over here. Let's do two. Well, we can graph this exact thing. So what I want to do now is generate that table of values. Once I have that table of values and I have the highlight and the focus down here, you'll notice there's a couple graphs we can choose from. There's a connected graph and a group of discrete points. That's really up to your preference what you want to take a look at. I think I'm going to need to auto zoom to fit the data so we get a sense of that. And one nice feature when you are graphing like this, if you click on the lower window with your table of values, you can actually turn on the link between the graph and this table. So when I click a specific point, notice this magenta marker goes from point to point, just to show what you're tracing across. So that's pretty handy. I will close that again. And lastly, we'd like to take a look at a cobweb diagram. So I have set up here a sub n plus 1 equal to a sub n squared over 2 minus 1. I had to set it up to be rather specific because cobweb diagrams, in order to get really interesting results, there's only certain kinds of functions that will work. And I picked an initial starting point of 2, just that's a little more interesting than some. And so I can generate a table, but to really do a true cobweb diagram, it's nice to start just from this. Or if you do create a table, don't use this at this point. Make sure the top is highlighted, the top box, and then use the cobweb diagram. And you'll find a starting point. In this case, a sub 0 is 2. And what will happen, and if you've used these before, you'll know what's going on. Otherwise, it may seem a little strange. This is your initial point of 2. And so if we feed a sub 0 of 2 in here, we're going to square it, divided by 2 minus 1, so it's going to become 4 over 2 is 2, minus 1 is 1. So when I press execute, it's going to bounce up until a y value of 1. Then what we do is that we're going to move, press execute again, it's going to move back to this line y equals x, and it's going to reinsert it into the function. It's going to drop to this point. And then pressing execute again is going to move horizontally over to that y equals x line, and then move vertically to touch the function, move horizontally, then move vertically to touch the function, move horizontally and vertically again to touch the function. And what you end up having happen is this point is sort of homing in on the intersection of our curve and this line y equals x. It's a really interesting analysis. It's something you would potentially come across in a class on the mathematics related to chaos. And this is what's known as an attractor. Depending on your initial starting point, it may attract to a certain point, or it may be repelled and just shoot off the graph. So sort of outside the scope of what this function or what this application does, but in any case, it can be pretty fun to use if you know what you're doing. So thanks again for watching this video, and I hope you check out our other videos.